fact that we have a packed room here tonight really, to me, signifies the urgency with which we all feel that we need to have these conversations in America, especially right now. I have to say that when my book was released just a few weeks ago in early November, little did I really expect that its themes around Islamophobia and xenophobia and racial anxiety would be brought into sharp focus again, as it has been with the backlash that we're seeing in our communities after the horrific attacks in Paris and the xenophobic political rhetoric that we're also seeing. But the truth of the matter is that what we're seeing today is actually what we saw yesterday and years before. For the past 14 years, the climate of fear and suspicion in this country has seeded what we're seeing today in a more overt fashion. There's a misguided perception that the post-9/11 backlash was limited to the months and years right after 9/11, but that's simply not the case, as many of you in this room know. And I know it firsthand because for over the past 14 years, I have had, unfortunately, a front row, frontline seat to the theater of post-9/11 America. At the time of the attack, I was actually working as an attorney at the Civil Rights Division at the US Department of Justice in Washington, DC. And within hours, many of us began to hear about Sikh men who were being chased down streets of Manhattan, being called terrorists, of Muslim and Arab community members who were being detained and interrogated from their stores, from their streets, who were detained while they were traveling. We began to hear about and see images that I think have become entrenched in our collective national imagination of what, quote, a terrorist looks like, and unfortunately, many of those images happen to look like some of the people that are featured on this book cover. So as I say in my book, many of us entered a period of a double grieving in the days after 9/11 for, of course, what had happened on that day, the horrible events of that day and the loss of life. But then when we started to realize that our communities would actually be scapegoated for what occurred. So in my time after DOJ and at SALT, South Asian Americans Leading Together, which is a national nonprofit that was really shaped by the post-9/11 moment, I, along with other South Asian Muslim, Arab, and Sikh American activists, realized very quickly that post-9/11 America is a daily phenomenon for our communities. It's one in which hate violence, or the threat of it, has become ever present. This is a picture of one of the relatives of Balbir Singh Sodhi, who was the first man who was killed after 9/11 on September 15th. It is an environment in which people from South Asia and the Middle East have become known as the disappeared, because they were literally taken off street corners from their stores and their homes, interrogated, profiled, surveilled, detained, and deported by our government in the domestic war on terror, which conflates national security and immigration policies and continues to do so with names such as the Alien Absconder Initiative and the Special Registration Program, names of policies that many of us don't even know about. It's an environment in a country where our people are told time and again that safety is elusive, whether it is within the walls of our mosques, our gurdwaras, our temples, the safe spaces that we had built. And we receive daily signals through political rhetoric in the media that this is not our country, that we should go home, that we're diluting the true nature of America, that our languages, customs, traditions, and backbreaking work are all desirable and acceptable when it comes to couture, cuisine, and jobs that many Americans don't want to do, but it's not acceptable when it means accessing benefits, rights, economic, linguistic, educational opportunities, and really just a country where we can feel that we belong and are safe and are welcome. So this is the backdrop that was occurring when I wrote this book last year. And I think that what has happened over the course of the past 14 years is that three different forces have come together. And so the book actually has a couple of different goals in mind that I just wanted to share with you all. One is to document the lived experiences, as Soya was talking about, of South Asian, Sikh, Arab, and community members with the hope that their voices will fill in some of the knowledge gaps that exist about what post-9/11 America even is. The second is to make the link between those three forces I mentioned, Islamophobia, anti-Muslim sentiment, xenophobia, anti-immigrant sentiment, and racial anxiety due to the demographic changes that we're seeing in our country. So in the book, I explore how anti-Muslim sentiment has actually become a backdoor to putting in place legislation and policies that affect immigrants, refugees, and broader sets of communities. And then to provide some calls to action for South Asian Muslim, Arab, and Sikh community members in particular. So I talk a little bit in the book about why we as a community have to dismantle the racial hierarchy in the United States, one that is built on the foundations of anti-Black racism, and that we need to do that by declining the offer to accept what scholars and sociologists call the racial bribe and honorary whiteness, that we need to move beyond those exceptional narratives that we ourselves create about spelling bee champions and Silicon Valley entrepreneurs to make room for the experience of Nepali domestic workers, or Muslim LGBTQ community members, or undocumented Indian youth. And the book also seeks to talk about how we win. And we win when we actually organize across race, across other sorts of lines that divide us. And there are parts of the book that really center the participation of South Asian Muslim, Arab, and Sikh immigrant communities, whether it's in, for example, fights to end racial profiling or surveillance, or whether it's around the immigrant rights movement or the movement for Black lives. And lastly, the book asks some questions about how these communities in particular and our allies can really shape a more inclusive democracy in the United States, especially given those transformative demographic changes that we're seeing in the United States. So given these goals, the book is kind of heavy and concerns itself with, you know, some painful issues that affect many of us in a very personal, deeply personal manner. But for me, what is most heartening about this book are the voices of young people that animate it. People like Drust, a Kurdish refugee in Tennessee who has been pushing back against a virulent anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim legislative campaign in Tennessee. People like Bupin, who is an undocumented gay man in Los Angeles, who through his courageous presence is actually pushing the immigrant rights movement to be more inclusive. People like Mustafa, an Egyptian-American Muslim advocate in St. Louis, who is making important connections between the movement for Black lives and Palestinian liberation. And Kamal, a young immigrant from Oak Creek, Wisconsin, who experienced a significant personal loss at his local gurdwara, which is a Sikh house of worship. So with that in mind, and the goals of the book, I wanted to read to you a few passages that actually focus on Kamal, the young man in Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and his story. So this is from the first chapter in the book, which is called Not Our American Dream. It was early on a Sunday morning in August 2012, and Paramjeet Kaur Saini was going about her morning routine. Her sons, 20-year-old Kamal Singh Saini and 18-year-old Harpreet Singh Saini, wanted to sleep in a little longer. So Paramjeet set out on her own to the local Gurdwara, the Sikh temple of Wisconsin. Paramjeet was a familiar presence there, and it had become a second home to her family and to many other Sikhs in Oak Creek, which is a small city located in the outskirts of Milwaukee. The Gurdwara, built in 2007 on 13 acres of land by Sikh immigrant families, sits on South Howell Street, just a few miles from the Milwaukee airport. And on weekends, Sikh families would gather at the Gurdwara to pray and connect with one another. The dining hall was always filled with the sounds of people laughing and socializing during langar, which is a free meal offered to anybody who visits the Gurdwara. Kamal and Harpreet usually hung out with their friends and played football on Sundays there, while their mother helped in the kitchen and the prayer hall. But August 5th, 2012 would not turn out to be a normal Sunday for Paramjeet's family or for the Oak Creek community. Soon after his mother had left the house, news reached Kamal that people inside the Sikh Temple of Wisconsin were in danger. Details were scarce, and panic-stricken, Kamal rushed to the Gurdwara to find that law enforcement vehicles had blocked off the driveway. Authorities asked him to wait across the street in the parking lot of a bowling alley, where he joined others who were also anxiously searching for information. While waiting there, Kamal and others speculated about what was happening inside the Gurdwara. Some thought that perhaps a dispute between community members had gone awry. Then, one of their friends, Kirandeep, received a call from her father. He was inside. He whispered that he was hiding in the pantry of the kitchen because he had heard gunshots. He was one of around 25 people huddled, terrified, among bags of rice and fresh vegetables. Kirandeep's father said, "Don't come to the Gurdwara under any circumstances." As the day wore on, many of the people who had been inside were allowed to leave, and a fuller picture began to emerge about the rampage that had occurred inside the Gurdwara that Sunday morning. Not seeing his mother and becoming increasingly anxious about her safety, Kamal left the parking lot. He called his friends, and together they went from hospital to hospital, hoping that Paramjit had been brought to one. It would be a full 11 hours before authorities finally notified Kamal that his mother had been one of six people fatally shot inside the Gurdwara. "When I first found out, I passed out," Kamal said. "I woke up in an ambulance and immediately thought of my little brother. Telling him was the hardest thing I've ever done." This wasn't the future that Paramjit had envisioned for her family when she and her two sons moved to America from India in 2004 to join her husband, who owned a number of gas stations in Wisconsin. It wasn't the life that Paramjit had planned to build when she mustered up the courage a few years later to begin working at a medical factory nearby. But Paramjit's determination to care for her family is a point of deep pride for her two sons. 45 days after his mother was killed, Harpreet spoke about her in testimony before the United States Senate. He said, "My mother was a brilliant woman, a reasonable woman. Everyone knew she was smart, but she never had the chance to get a formal education. She couldn't. As a hardworking immigrant, she had to work long hours to feed her family, to get her sons educated, to make sure that we could achieve our American dreams. This was more important to her than anything else. But now she's gone. Because of a man who hated her, because she wasn't his color, his religion. She was an American, but this was not our American dream." Now, it's important to remember that what happened in Oak Creek was part and parcel of the post-9/11 backlash that we have seen over the last 14 years. But the path to Oak Creek actually began more than a century ago in this country. So South Asian Arab, Hindu, Muslim, and Sikh communities experienced unprecedented backlash after 9/11, but hate violence targeting these communities has a much larger history. Arabs have faced high levels of suspicion, discrimination, and violence in the late 70s and early 90s when the Iran hostage crisis and the Persian Gulf War occurred. And for South Asians, including those who are Hindu, Muslim, or Sikh, they have been targets of hate crimes from the Bellingham, Washington riots of 1907 to the Dotbuster scare in the 1980s in New Jersey, and street violence that's been targeting our community members in more recent decades. The riots in Bellingham, which occurred in the early part of the 20th century, are meaningful to understand the roots of anti-Asian sentiment. At the time, as you all know, all along the West Coast, Chinese, Korean, Filipino, Japanese, and Indian workers were exploited for their labor but not welcomed as residents or US citizens. These racist attitudes were reinforced by laws such as the Chinese Exclusion Act and anti-naturalization policies. But they also often took the form of actual violence. And that's what happened on September 4th, 1907 in Bellingham. 500 white residents rounded up around 200 South Asian migrant workers, most of them Sikhs and Hindus, and locked them in the basement of the city hall. They intended to drive out immigrant laborers who worked under contract in Bellingham's lumber mills. Unsurprisingly, Bellingham's xenophobic reactions to South Asian migrant labor reflected views institutionalized in laws and expressed in the media. The Bellingham Herald, for example, published an editorial the day after the riots that read, "The Hindu is not a good citizen. It would require centuries to assimilate him, and this country need not take the trouble. Our racial burdens are already heavy enough to bear." Just a side note that about 100 years later, in 2007 actually, the Bellingham Herald did publish an apology for what occurred in the community. Yes, 100 years, not too bad of a time period, right? So I want to end the reading by taking you back to Oak Creek, Wisconsin, and talking a little bit about the memorial service that occurred there. So I arrived in Oak Creek 5 days after the massacre occurred to pay my respects at the memorial for the six victims of the tragedy. As I approached Oak Creek High School, the site of the memorial service, I could see hundreds of people who were waiting in line outside. People of all races and faiths had gathered in the quintessential American space, a high school gymnasium, to mourn the six Sikh immigrants who had lost their lives to hate violence in America's heartland. The gym echoed with the spontaneous call and response of Bole So Nihal, Sat Sri Akal, from the Sikhs in the audience. As the memorial program began, we were asked to pay our respects to the victims by lining up to view the open caskets. I tried to prepare myself for looking into the faces of the six innocent people who had lost their lives, but I was even more shaken as I realized that next to each casket stood their children. What do you say to comfort a child who has lost a parent in such a senseless act of hate? Next to Satwan Singh Kaleka's casket stood his two adult sons, Amardeep and Pardeep. Flanking Ranjit Singh's casket was his 14-year-old son, Gurvinder, who actually saw his father for the first time in his casket. Next to Paramjit Kaur's casket stood Kamal and Harpreet. I murmured the only words of comfort and reassurance that I could muster. "Our community will stand by you," I said. And I believed these words firmly and fully in my heart, but I also knew that they could provide little solace at the time. For myself and other Sikh American leaders, like Jasjeet Singh and Amardeep Singh, we knew that we had many questions. We asked ourselves, how could this have happened again? How can our community bear it? What more could have been done after 9/11 to prevent this massacre from occurring? We would ask ourselves these questions for months and years afterward. The memorial service proceeded with a number of speeches from community members and elected officials, including Attorney General Eric Holder. And he said something of significance. He said, "Unfortunately, this sort of violence has become all too common in recent years." And it's true, the public backlash that Sikhs, Muslims, Hindus, South Asians, and Arabs have experienced since 9/11 had indeed become all too common by 2012. But it's important to remember that it did not happen in a vacuum. The violence was reinforced by racist, anti-Muslim, and xenophobic political rhetoric, by media narratives that stereotype and dehumanize our communities, and by the government's own policies and programs that target and profile these same communities in the name of national security. So the rest of that chapter talks about the way in which the community of Oak Creek responded, how they have been trying to heal, and it talks about how it is a community-wide response to hate violence that they're trying to actually model themselves after in that particular town. And it also talks about the fact that in our country, the biggest threat these days is actually around right-wing domestic terror groups that are organizing, that are focused on white supremacy, that are focused on the demographic changes that we're seeing in this country. So that's kind of how the rest of the chapter ends. So at the same time that South Asian, Muslim, Arab, and Sikh immigrant communities have been placed into chaos and struggle in the years after 9/11, there have been significant, meaningful, transformative changes happening in our country. The Movement for Black Lives reminds us with urgency to stay woke, to say her name, to disrupt. And Muslim, Arab, South Asian communities are responding by standing firm in solidarity as allies and conspirators. From Palestine to Ferguson, justice for all. We're claiming that we're not anyone's model minority. In short, we're making it plain that we stand with increasing power at the intersections of multiple movements as feminists and reproductive rights activists, as immigrants speaking with confidence in the cadence of Urdu, Arabic, Bangla, Gujarati, and Tamil, as queer and transgendered people, as undocumented people with intersectional identities, as workers, and as allies of global movements related to climate change, the solidarity economy, and human rights. So that, to me, is the hope for how we press forward in our struggle for racial justice and equity. And the book also includes, as Soya said, I do calls to action. So it has some calls to action for all of us, not surprisingly. I actually just want to read to you some of the calls to action that I've been hearing from people that I've been talking to actually around the country. The book asks that we are disruptors of kind of the prevailing cultural narratives and norms that we usually hear about Muslim, Arab, South Asian, and Sikh immigrants. And it also asks us to build bridges. And on your seat, you should have a postcard that has the picture of the cover of the book, but on the back of it, I'm actually asking each of you to take a pledge. If any part of this conversation and the conversation we're about to have moves you, that you take a pledge in terms of what you're willing to do to be a disruptor, to be a bridge builder. And if you don't mind, if you put your email address on there or your mailing address, I will be in touch with you in a few months just to remind you about your pledge. You can count on that. So these are some of the responses that I've been hearing from people. I'll work with my state public schools to expand curricula to include some of the issues affecting these communities, or I'll have a hard conversation with my Indian grandfather about anti-Black racism. I'll support a local mosque that's been the site of anti-Muslim or anti-Islam rallies, which is actually happening all around the country these days. I'll write letters to the local editor of the newspaper that perpetuates terrorist perceptions of our communities. I'll ask my elected leaders about their stance on domestic terrorism. I'll sign a statement, this is important, to support Muslim, Arab, and South Asian communities, which is actually up right now on Race Files, www.racefiles.com. And there is a statement right now that we're asking folks to sign onto to show your support and solidarity with our community members.
We have some limited time and a lot of ground to cover, so we're just gonna jump right in. So, you know, for historical context, just in the last week when we were planning this event, we were talking on the phone, and I think it was Chandan who said, well, who knows what's going to happen between now and Tuesday, right? And we did. We saw the shootings of protesters in Minneapolis. We saw the shooting up of the Planned Parenthood clinic in Colorado. We've seen backlash against Muslims, Arabs, and South Asians, including physical assaults, vandalism at mosques, and armed protests. We've also seen Chicago's cover-up of a police murder of a 16-year-old youth named Laquan McDonald, 17-year-old, excuse me. Ongoing killings of Black and brown people, detentions, deportations. But these things, they're not new, right? And our resistance is also not new. So Chandan, can you give us some historical context for what we're seeing today, both in terms of the attacks and also the resistance that we're seeing?
Can you hear me okay? Yeah. All right. So I'm going to try to say a lot in 5 minutes. So if I go fast, just I apologize in advance. So the task that I was given, as Soya just shared, was to talk a little bit about the longer history of the othering of Muslim, South Asian, Middle Eastern peoples and the causes behind that othering. So to do so, it's useful to kind of return to the late 19th century and to think a little bit about the origins of much of these discourses. Asian migration, like much migration in the United States, was ongoing labor migration in the period of the 19th century. There were migration happening in the southeast, southern United States that was connected to the peninsular trade with the Spanish galleon trades. There was migration on the west coast and northeast and so forth. It wasn't until the late 19th century that Asians became targeted specifically as a form of racial otherness or as a form of foreign other that needed to be separated and segregated both politically and socially in the United States. The idea of Asians and Muslims as other to the United States, as foreign, is not coincidental, but is really a consequence of the specific history of racialization of Asians and Muslims and Middle Eastern peoples, which has been primarily through the immigration system, as well as the history of US wars abroad. So even though we continue to wonder how it is that Asians appear to us as foreign others, even when they're third or fourth generation, we have to know that one of the reasons is because of the ways in which they've been racialized in this country and the specific apparatuses that have done that work, which have been immigration and US militarism abroad. Now, for much of the 19th and 20th century, Asians were considered an excludable population, which meant that they were allowed to be in the United States as workers, but they were not allowed to be participatory in the US as citizens or as cultural subjects. And in fact, Deepa mentions in her book, for example, in Bellingham, the Bellingham riots where they, you know, took people onto the streets and they beat them and they took their things, was preceded by laws that actually had stated that South Asian laborers were allowed to be in Bellingham during the period of the season in which you need high labor, such as during the period of picking, such as the period of canning, or the period of cutting wood, but that when there wasn't seasonal labor demands, South Asians were barred from being on the streets of Bellingham. So they were literally labor that could be present during work, and had to be entirely made invisible and disappeared as cultural and social and political members of US society and community. That long history of racialization, and I'm gonna do this really quickly, that long history of racializing Asians as others really continued much through the 20th century up until 1965. And some of the consequence of the way that Asians have been racialized as others is that Asians were excluded through immigration based upon nationality. So the first population that was excluded was Chinese in 1882. The second population that was excluded were the Japanese in 1917. The Gentlemen's Agreement, US Gentlemen's Agreement Act, which I think is 1912. I could be wrong. The third population that were excluded were the groups of the Asiatic Barred Zones, which were three areas that included South Korea, India, and contemporary Taiwan in 1917, and so on and so forth. So one of the tactics of US society and US government has been to racialize Asians as specific national populations for the practice of controlling and justifying migration and citizenship policies. So nationality for Asians is not arbitrary. And the meaning of nationality and the production of needing to know people's nationality for Asians comes out of this exact history. And it's particularly relevant at this moment where you see that we are in a moment in which the multiplicity of Asian identities, and I think Gibran and Gabrielle really pulled this out, the multiplicity of Asian identities are confounding many of the ways people have come to know Asians. So Asians are also Muslim as much as they are national identity. Muslims are also black as much as they are Asian. Refugees are as much people of color as they are, so on and so forth. And so what you're seeing at this moment is a radical confusing of the nationality logic that has racialized Asian, and it's been the source of some of the most interesting cultural work that we just heard, as well as some of the most interesting, important bridges and resistances that Deepa's book talks about. So moving on to the period, the last thing I'll say about the period of exclusion is that the period of the late 19th and early 20th century, exclusion had had two tactics around Asians. One was to recruit their labor and to make their labor cheaper by being able to exclude them from citizenship rights. Two, the exclusion of South Asians was oftentimes a way of negotiating the dual demands for making white supremacy a meaningful doctrine, so being able to give white people, even working white people, rights above and beyond those of others, as well as needing to deal with the demands of a growing and expanding economy. So the populist movements of white supremacy that you see in Washington and California and elsewhere were precisely at this intersection of the need to support white supremacy and the need to grow the economy simultaneously. And you're seeing reverberations of that in this contemporary moment as well. The last part is that Asians were racialized through US militarism as well as through Western militarism more generally and US participation in it. And we can talk a lot more about how that works out in the contemporary moment, but let me take you to the historical period and tell you a little bit that one, South Asians are a very interesting population. West Coast South Asians are a very interesting population in this regard. They came to the Northwest, meaning the US side of the Northwest, Washington State, Oregon, California, and so forth, mainly as derelict workers from from Vancouver. They were colonial labor that was recruited from Punjab and Gujarat and other places and brought to be colonial labor for building the British Empire in British Columbia and the British industries. And they were oftentimes the ones who went vagrant from those jobs. They were oftentimes the ones who left. Now, they were also oftentimes brought from India to Vancouver because they were seen as anti-colonial agitators doing too much agitation in their home country. And so most of those people have anti-colonial labor and national organizing. When they came to Britain, when British Columbia, they were the target of tremendous surveillance. And the reason we have such high documentation of them is because of how much surveillance they were under. And in fact, one of the things that happens then is that they get kicked out of Vancouver because of the activism they're doing. And Britain and the US start to share surveillance information with one another to track South Asians between the border of Canada and the US. So the first beginnings of the modern surveillance state happen around the regulation of South Asians, and particularly around the regulation of anti-colonial movements to the West, of which South Asians are one representative group. So that history sort of is in this moment, and we can talk about that as well. The last thing I'll just say is that the period of exclusion that I've been talking about, the period in which Asians were denied the right of citizenship and were considered a dangerous foreign other, including Japanese American internment during this surveillance state period that I was talking about in 45, we understand that period as having come to an end in 1965 with the development of the 1965 Immigration Act, which is celebrating its 50th anniversary this year. Now, the 65 Immigration Act is seen as this kind of watershed moment in which Asians are no longer racialized as the other, even though if you read, and you must, Deepa's book is one of the most amazing reads that I have had in the last 2 years of reading books. It is one of the most important books you can read right now in our moment. So I can't stress enough how powerful it is. Oh, it's incredible. It's incredible. And it shares with you this incredible activist history of Asian immigrant and Asian refugee and Asian American organizing that is all too invisible and so has been part of the misrecognition of Asian history and Asian politics. But to go back to this period of post-65, the one thing that you have to know is that the lifting of immigration restrictions and the sort of called free period of the post-65 has actually not been that at all. And I'm not going to go too much into it because Deepa's book shares a lot about that information. What I do want to share is one aspect of that, which is, or two. One is the, I know, here we go again. One is that post-65 was the period in which Asians were being lifted from restrictionist quotas, but every nation was gaining its own quota. So it was the first period in which Latinos and Mexican people were being counted by the US state. And the contemporary anti-Latino politics we have, the contemporary politics of anti-illegal aliens and so on, is actually a consequence of the 65 law. They were not part of this before 65. So the so-called lifting of Asian restriction coincides with the intensification and the creation of Latino racialization and the undocumented groups of people that we see now. So our histories are very conjoined in very important ways that we have to deal with and now unravel. The second point that I just want to make about 65.
You have 15 seconds.
Okay, it's internal stratification, which is that in post-65 period, one of the things you have to know about Asian communities is just true of other communities is that you see tremendous internal stratification. So you get recruitment of top-end skilled labor and recruitment of bottom-end labor. And when you look at Asian groups, they are more stratified than any other racial group. And when you look at the bottom three quartiles, so the bottom three-fifths of the group, they have higher rates of poverty, higher rates of unemployment than even Latinos and African Americans at time in urban areas. So they're in very many
Thank
ways
you.
Dealing with that situation.
I'm sorry.
Ubach, tell us, please, talk a little bit about the importance of solidarity among communities of color right now, what that looks like here in Seattle in terms of the organizing that's happening, what you feel like some of the places of promise are, and also some of the challenges that you see.
Can you hear me? No. You need this.
I wanted to get away with it.
Yeah, exactly. Do you want me to hold?
So before I talk about that, I wanted to weave in a little bit of my story. I came to the United States. First of all, my identities include African immigrant, a Muslim woman. I'm also a mother of three children, two tall and handsome black boys. And as a black immigrant woman who grew up in a homogeneous society in Somalia, when I first came here to Seattle, I noticed my privilege and also the impact that the system here imposes on us. And an example of my own privilege I noticed is like, I didn't have to think about my blackness or my race until I came here. Until I had to fill in a job application and I had to check that box, and I was struggling with, and it just had African American, actually it didn't have black. And then it was followed by me trying to fill out an application for a scholarship which was dedicated for African American. And my counselor at the time was like, you know, you're African immigrant, you're in America, that makes you African American. I struggled with it, I privileged from it, I ended up applying for it, but I notice right now as my boys are growing up here, they were born here, they actually struggle with their identity as early as kindergarten, you know? My oldest son noticed the disproportionality in discipline when he was in kindergarten, and he's like, Mom, you know, like we all do the same things, but I noticed that the boys that look like me are punished more, you know? And fast forward 5 years later, I came here at the age of 15, 9/11 happened. My community was, you know, like being privileged by the system, you know? But 9/11 happened and our communities started becoming under attack because of that, you know. We started being called terrorists and things like that, and we actually started fighting for that, right? But as I reflected upon that, I started thinking about the African-American struggle, the black struggle. They've gone through centuries and centuries of these oppressive systems. And no other communities of color has been able to go through that struggle the way that African Americans went through. So how do we combat this, you know, oppressions? One of the ways that we do, like as a person that I have organized through coalitions and multi-ethnic and multi-racial coalitions, is like we build power through coalition, right? But we know that there's challenges in coalition buildings and things like that. And one of the things that I've noticed, and I like using my own examples and things like that, is as communities of color, as immigrants, a lot of time we benefit from the struggle of African American by using their struggle, by like quoting Malcolm X, quoting Martin Luther King, and all those figures. But when it comes to like black crisis, when it comes to black and African-American men being hit and killed in the streets, we're like all of a sudden, wow, that's not my issue. Let me use the East Africans, for example. Like I said, we are black, as you can see. But a lot of times when things like that happen, we're like, wait a minute, I'm Somali-American. Wait a minute, I'm Kenyan-American. You know, this is not my issue, you know? And I've been like, actually the last year and a half, as I, you know, a multi-parent raising my own kids, struggling with what is my place in this movement, you know? Is my place trying to figure out and use my own privilege of understanding race and class and connecting all the isism of colonialism, racism, you know, feminism, to educate my community, to say that Black Lives Matter is our lives too. It affects us. You know, Deepa, a lot of talks in her books, she uses concrete examples of, for example, Mr. Patel was, you know, he came to visit his son in the United States from India, and he was just like taking a walk when he was a neighbor called the police because of a suspicious skinny, what he quote unquote called him was black man. The police came here, there. There was misunderstanding because they didn't understand he didn't understand the language. You know, they ended up, you know, he ended up being paralyzed because of the way they handled him. You know, what I appreciated from the book was like Deepa talks about how the South Asian community organized. They wrote letters, you know, they tried to figure out what their purpose was, what their place was in this movement. And they were able to like make it happen where the they were able to make the police officer ended up being indicted this year, right? So a lot of the what excites me about the Black Lives Matter is it reminds me of the Policy Link, you know, tagline where it says equity is the superior growth model, right? And it reminds me that in that if we all, like as communities of color, work on the Black Lives Matter movement, it will elevate all our issues, you know? Our issues are different. Our struggles are different. At the end of the day, they are connected. And I'm not saying let us conflate, you know, our struggles, our issues with the African-American issues, what I'm saying, or Black issues. What I'm saying is because the people who are most impacted by these systems are Africans, are Black Americans. If we work together in Black Lives Matter through coalition building, through multiracial coalition building, we'll elevate all our needs. That's what I'm saying.
Thank you so much, Iba. I'm not sure exactly how to handle this, but Deepa had asked me to talk about, I guess I'll just start talking. I'll moderate myself. Okay, so Deepa had asked me to talk about the moment now in terms of opportunities for movement building with an Asian American lens, just I think given the work that we've been doing at Change Lab. And so I guess I wanna say that, you know, for a while, there has been a sense that the Asian American politics of, say, the late 60s, a commitment to interracial solidarity, a commitment to fight greed and capitalism and exploitation and imperialism and war, that those things kind of, Asian American leaders sort of stopped talking about those things as explicitly. I mean, as did a lot of people, right, for various reasons. But I think that there's a new yearning and a new hunger to kind of revitalize and rebuild the Asian American movement. And given what's happening in South Asian, Sikh, Muslim, and Arab communities and the ways that those issues have not, by and large, been taken up and centralized by more mainstream Asian Pacific Islander organizations and leadership, we have an opportunity to learn from those experiences and make the connections that Chandan was helping us to make to our own histories, right, and see this as our fight in the same way that we have the opportunity to see what Black Lives Matter, that movement is doing and how we have a real investment in actually throwing our weight down behind that fight as well. So there are organizations, you know, we are seeing growing Asian American organizing. Another very exciting development that's happening is with the Southeast Asian community, which this is now the 40th anniversary of the arrival of the first Southeast Asian refugees after the wars in Vietnam, the wars in Southeast Asia. And for a long time, or for about, you know, since 2002, there has been a deportation crisis in the Cambodian community. And people have responded by really trying to fight that in Congress. And what's happening this year in a new campaign that the Southeast Asian Freedom Network and One Love Movement in Philadelphia is really leading is a campaign to end deportations of people in Southeast Asian communities who have criminal convictions. This is as a result of 1996 laws that massively expanded the grounds for deportation for people with criminal convictions with no judicial review. And makes it retroactive, right? So this is a crisis in the community, and they're moving, shifting away from Congress, where really the battle is how tough can you be on immigration, right? The battle is not about human rights or kind of, you know, a moral commitment to humanitarianism even, right? It really is a contest over how tough can you be. We saw this even in Obama's latest executive action, where he did provide relief to certain undocumented people, but using the tagline, felons not families, right? Well, felons have families, right? I mean, that is a false division and only serves to criminalize segments of our communities, right? So they've decided to abandon, you know, for now, the congressional fight and really shift the focus on these repatriation agreements between the United States and Cambodia, Vietnam, and Laos. And in those repatriation agreements, which are literally 6 to 8 pages long compared to like a 1,000-page bill in Congress, for example, by shifting the attention to those repatriation agreements, it also shifts the frame to a frame of war and imperialism and Western intervention and the, and America's obligation in light of those things, right? So that's one exciting opportunity. I also think that there are amazing conversations and organizing and activism happening across the board in Asian and Pacific Islander communities in solidarity with Black Lives Matter. One example of that that's happening now, which seems small, but actually really is very important for us. Deepa mentioned dealing with anti-blackness in our own communities, and I know there's a group called API Resistance that is actually having these conversations over, you know, Thanksgiving dinner with your family members about how you feel about Black people, where those ideas come from. And it's, they actually wrote a blog post about it, and you know, I'll share it on Facebook if you guys are my Facebook friends. it's really great, you know, and it's very powerful, and it's very complicated, and it's shaped by some of the things that Chandan was talking about, the history of colonialism, the history of these hierarchies created by immigration policy, et cetera. So those are some of the things that that I will mention, and just also to say that in this moment, we're talking about this more because Black Lives Matter has opened up new political space for all of us to have these conversations and to take bolder action. But there are also organizations like this, he's rising up and moving, like CAV organizing Asian communities in New York, that have for a long time made a commitment to police accountability in solidarity with Black and brown communities because they understand that the system of white supremacy is built on anti-blackness and the economic and political structures that people are fighting, whether it's, you know, fighting for tenants' rights or low-wage worker rights, is grounded in a system that has been constructed on white supremacy. So that's all I have to say about that. And I think at this point, we could have this conversation with these, you know, 3 billion people up here all night long, but we want to open up the conversation with all of you.
Hi, hello. I'm Nat Mengist. I guess I'm fearless, going first, all right. I'm not. So my brother is going to be a cop, and he's been in the Navy for a number of years. And I'm always concerned because I know that as a black man, I mean, we're Ethiopian immigrants, so we're both second generation, he and I. I have this thing like, oh, he has to represent, you know, he has to be in the system to make changes, otherwise I'll be as upset at him as I happen to be at just random policemen and women I see on the street. So I guess my question, because he does educate himself and he does want to educate his communities and push, you know, his peers to be able to think more justly about these issues, if any or all of you had any advice specifically for someone like that who wants to be in the system and wants to create that change, but possibly knows that they're going to get all different kinds of pushback, they're going to be in a different, kind of a difficult situation.
Thank you very much.
I'm a radical, so I don't believe in the system.
I know. I hear you on that.
But,
I wanted to slap him when I heard the cop thing. The Navy's one, but you want to be a cop, dude? What? Yeah.
But I think he can, if he brings in, like, I think for me it was important to have, like, I mean, I saw all these disparities, all these inequities happening, but until I got the race and class analysis of why it's happening and, like, connecting it with the history, I wasn't able to question the system. But if he gets that and doesn't act as a gatekeeper, I think that there's a way that he can, I don't want to say benefit the system, but benefit the people. By actually, you know, educating the people that he works with, mm-hmm. you know? Why is he doing this work, you know? Why is he working within this system that he believes in? Like, because, for example, like, for me, as an East African, as an immigrant, I came from a corrupted government. I saw the corrupted government. I saw the government topple up, and it wasn't benefiting anybody. But what is illusionary in this system, it's a system that is full, it's working, but it's set up in a way that it's benefiting certain people, but oppressing others over and over, and it's evident in the court system, in the justice system here. So I think it's really important to understand that and be able to educate the folks that he's working with. Right. That's my take, without being a radical.
Thank you.
So thank you all, I'm just learning so much. And so I lived for 6 years in Bellingham. And I also worked for Western in their Office of Admissions, doing multicultural work. So a whole lot of like taking in everything you're talking about, a lot of that. I'm curious to know, and I'm still really bad at reading. I'm gonna keep this one completely 100 right now. I don't read very often. So when I find a good book to read, I definitely wanna pick it up and try to read it. So that being said, one of the things I struggled with, both as a student and when I was working on the administration side, which I highly encourage you not to ever do when you come straight out of college. But one of the things I struggled with was connecting with the South Asian students about anti-blackness and what that looks like, and realizing that a lot of that may have been perpetuated by faculty, South Asian faculty. And I'm interested to know on your own experiences of what that looks like on the faculty level. Is there anything happening? No, we don't like working in the system. I totally understand that too. And totally was that at the same time. But is there anything like that happening, and where is that avenue on that kind of level?
Similarly, when I was in college, you know, I was incredibly alienated from the South Asian organizing that was happening in these clubs. And one of the things that people need to know is that these clubs are really being sponsored structurally through Hindutva movements from India. So part of this is that this is, a lot like contemporary Zionism. This is a very concerted movement from India, as well as from Indian diasporic members, to take over educational space. So one of the things we had to do is figure out the relationship between Indian nationalism and anti-blackness at this moment. And I think Uba was making mention, again, that if you work on Black Lives Matter, you might actually be able to undo something about Indian nationalism. So I think that is some of the hopeful stuff that we're at this moment. In terms of faculty, you know, I don't know about particular South Asian faculty, meaning I think there's an important study to be made about the political ideologies of Indian scientists and how they have shaped the racial politics of universities, particularly, for example, in the UC system. What has been their relationship to the ending of affirmative action? Where, you know, what has been their position as they've been recruited? So I don't have that answer for you. But I think it's a really important question. What I would say to concur with you is that the idea that there are differences between South Asians and African Americans, that there are forms of cultural superiority and cultural dysfunction, these all came from the university. So it should not surprise anyone that the university is the locus of these kinds of inequalities. We have to make that fight happen there.
I would just quickly add that I think that there's a lot of room for South Asian campus organizing. I would even say Asian American campus organizing. I think that it's bleak, you know, in terms of people being politicized and actually having conversations like these, which they should be having on campuses. But best practice that I have noticed is actually through Muslim students associations. And I think Muslim students associations in many parts of the country have been able to grapple with issues of Islamophobia and xenophobia. But I think that the challenge there is that many, and hopefully we can talk about this a little bit more, but many Black Muslims who are actually not immigrant Muslims, right? But Black Muslims who are African Americans, a third of the Muslim community in this country, often feel that there's no space for them in terms of the Muslim Students Associations or other sorts of associations on campuses. But when that space is made to make these connections between Black struggle, as you were talking about, Uba, and also the struggles of Muslim immigrants or South Asian immigrants, I have seen, you know, some interesting dialogues happen. And there's a really great group called Muslim Arc that has been doing some dialogues online in particular to bridge the gaps and the divides between African American Muslims and immigrant Muslims who are South Asian or Arab. So I think that those are some dialogues that I think are really promising that are happening on college campuses too.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Zeki. So Hillary Clinton, a little while ago, a couple of months ago, met with some Black Lives Matter organizers. And I remember specifically she said, "I don't think you change hearts, you change policies." And that was in direct contrast to something I read in Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, which has said no, that she didn't agree. Well, I mean, that happened before, but her point was that you do have to change hearts. It has to start from the ground up. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts on that. Is it both? Is it, which one do you start with?
You're like my publicist.
I know.
But all three of you, I'm so flattered. Thanks for your question, Zeki. I think it is all of the above. I think it's heart change. I think it's cultural narrative change and disruption. And of course, it's policy and structural change. And I think that, you know, we have seen that, especially, I mean, I'll talk from my own experience in terms of working in South Asian, Arab, Muslim, and Sikh immigrant communities, that, you know, people have asked me quite a bit recently, is there a shift from what you saw in the days and years after 9/11? And yeah, there is a shift. There are some bright spots of progress. And where those are happening is actually around cultural narrative disruption. So there are more people, especially in the media, who are not going to let folks get away with that, you know, Muslim terrorist conflation. There are heart changes. You know, I think about that little white boy in Texas you might have seen who like brought his piggy bank to a mosque that had been threatened. So there are heart changes, right, where more people are standing up and saying, no, we're not going to tolerate this sort of treatment. But I think from a systemic standpoint, we have a long ways to go. And I do think that that's really where all of us need to push or pull our energy. So I think that, you know, America's lost its appetite for Islamophobia in its most overt ways. However, whether or not we are going to stand up to, you know, people running for office who say things like we want to register Muslims or, you know, build walls, and, you know, how are we going to actually call our policymakers to task, and how are we actually going to work to make sure that policies such as NSEERS or the Alien Absconder Initiative or surveillance of our community stops? That's where I think we have to kind of pool our energy and resources. But yes, all three. And I think there's some progress, at least on two of those pieces.
Thank you. Yeah, one more question. Hey, Brian.
My name is Brian Shi. Kind of following up on the student activism question, there's a lot of tech in the Pacific Northwest. A lot of folks of Asian descent work in a lot of these places. The notion of anti-Blackness never really comes up. I'm wondering, do you guys have any tips, suggestions on how to raise greater awareness, broader coalitions, with kind of this huge population base here that isn't as engaged as I potentially think they should be? Thanks.
I can start. I'm a sellout, and I moved to Bellevue to raise my kids there for opportunity. And this conversation is happening, you know, how... yeah.
It's okay, his brother is a cop, so... And you're a doctor. Yeah, exactly.
So I think for me, and talking about personal histories of what's happening right now is... connecting it with like the opportunity gap and who has access to technology. And for example, as I mentioned, my son, just him being in that zip code of opportunity, he has access to STEM classes that I don't have to pay for, you know, the school bus takes him everywhere. It's just engaging the folks that work on that technology system to be able to, like, first, it starts with working with communities that are impacted, right? Just kind of piggybacking to the question that the person before asked is, like, transformation from the ground up. It's first educating the folks, right, about the anti-blackness, actually checking your own, you know, racism and cultural superiority or ethnocentric, and actually working on yourself. Like, I myself, like I said, I'm a work in progress. I'm working on myself. I'm trying to figure out where I am in that movement and things like that. So educating, grassroots organizing, and then from there, coalition building. And these folks that are, like, in the tech industry have to realize these disparities and actually start following those coalitions and working on those coalitions, but it's grassroots. And working, starting from your own companies, like Google and all those companies have social justice groups that have already started meeting and, you know, talking about these issues.
I just want to quickly add, I think that to reach anyone who seems to be unreachable but should be reachable, I think it has to start when it starts to hit them personally. And I have seen that, especially with, you know, thank you for bringing up that example of Suresh Bhai Patel. I have seen, you know, Indian uncles and Indian entrepreneurs who seem very removed from any of these issues actually open up when that particular example is used to talk about how an Indian grandfather got assaulted by a white police officer on a street, a neighborhood street in Alabama. And then, when you know, people immediately are outraged. Well, how could this happen to him just because he didn't speak English and because he's an immigrant? And I've noticed that when those when those kinds of reactions come up, to then say, well, it's actually because of a tip that was about a skinny black guy. And by the way, this happens, you know, at disproportionate levels to black people all around the country. So I do think that when I've seen that sort of progress happen in terms of people's mind shifting and heart shifting, is when they can really connect to an example that's very relevant to them, that's very personal to them. And then slowly, I think we are starting to see folks who are in our generation and younger talk about the movement for black lives and talk about anti-black racism, and also how we, as our communities in the book, you know, there's a young man, Dante Berry, who runs a nonprofit called Million Hoodies United. He talks about the importance of our community seeing, you know, the criminal justice system, the incarceration machine, the deportation machine, the surveillance state, which has affected all of our communities in some similar ways, but also different outcomes. But he talks about how we can be co-conspirators. And I think that that's to me is something, you know, that's a work in progress for me. I think about that a lot. How can our communities show up as co-conspirators? Because these issues are affecting our communities as well. So that's, I think, the entry point.
Thank you. So this is a part of the evening that we're sadly, we do have to wrap up. So the last thing that Deepa is reminding me to do is calls to action. Shocking. So I'd like to actually invite the panelists up here to each share one call to action for all of us in this room to take away with us as we leave tonight. Okay.
My call to action actually starts with myself and figuring out what my place in this movement is. Is it educating my, you know, community around the Black Lives Matters and how it impacts them? Is it working with the Muslim community and telling them Muslim Americans were Arabs or East Africans, there was black there. Is it working with other and multiracial organizations or coalitions that is working on this? So the 2016 commitment that I'm making is starting that dialogue with my community instead of just thinking about it. And also call upon you to just make one, two, or even three commitments for 2016 of how are you gonna be working on this Black Lives Matter and dismantling the systems that dehumanize black people.
I think So I think my call to action is that I hope everyone commits to reading Deepa's book. Yeah, from beginning to end. Exactly, you can't choose chapters. And there's many concrete reasons for that, but one of the things that we didn't get to talk a lot about that I just want to put as part of the call to action is this is a moment of the Black Lives Matter movement also intersecting with some of the most important work happening in Latino politics on undocumented peoples, as well as not just Latino politics, but refugee politics and Asian politics around the increased hyper-militarization of detention and deportation and the increasingly blurring of the boundaries between Guantanamo and every single detention center that is the United States. And there's ongoing hunger strikes right now of 100 South Asian people in both Louisiana and Texas. There's solidarity strikes happening here in Tacoma against the GEO Center. And so my ask of you is that you go and find out what these hunger strikes are about, and that you connect with one of the groups organizing here in Seattle that's working particularly around the Tacoma Detention Center, and learn what their project is as you move forward.
Thank you, Chandan. That was really great. I'm glad you brought those hunger strikes up. So my call to action would be what Deepa mentioned earlier. So we have a post up on Race Files right now. It's at www.racefiles.com that we wrote to express solidarity with Muslim, Arab, and South Asian communities in this moment of violent backlash, but also to just draw the connections between what's happening in those communities and what has happened historically with Asian Pacific Islander communities in particular. And also placing it in the context of some of the themes that Deepa was talking about. So not only policy attacks, but political rhetoric and a kind of deep-seated and embedded culture of white supremacy in this country. So to please go to that statement and, you know, sign it if you'd like, but also more importantly, I think, share it, think about it, think about ways that you could maybe make a statement of your own from your organization or networks that you're part of, and just start having some of these conversations and think through what your personal connection is to some of the themes that we talked about tonight.
So I will close by saying that if you're here, right, all of us who are here are either concerned about these issues at some level, politicized around these issues at some level. So my call to action is actually to ask each of us to have a messy and difficult conversation with someone who doesn't get it. It could be a family member, it could be an organization that you're part of, an employee resource group, but to have a conversation on Islamophobia or the movement for Black Lives or racial anxiety, and it can be through storytelling, and I think that's really important that we do that, that we make the connection first by telling stories, that the point of entry that Ubao started with is powerful. So, you know, sharing your own points of entry into these conversations and then really eliciting some of that from others. There are resources out there to have those, you know, race talks. There's some in the back of my book, but there are groups like the Center for Social Inclusion, where I work, Race Forward, organizations I'm sure here locally as well, that really have the resources to enable us to have those kinds of conversations. And then I hope that you have filled out the postcard, because that's my other call to action. And I hope to see you out there with the postcards and just to say hello, because I'm just so thankful that you all are here, and so thankful that Chandan and Uba and Soya have been able to join me tonight as well. So I'll let you close it out.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone. So it's, yes, a round of applause.